introduce you to Grace. Grace, God's grace. No matter the bumps, no matter the bruises, no matter the scars, still the truth is the cross has made. The cross has made you flawless. The cross has made you flawless. And no matter the hurt or how deep the wound is, no matter the pain, still the truth.
Glad that you are here and chose to assemble with us today. As you can see, we've got a different worship experience. I think you're going to thoroughly not only enjoy it, but I hope it leads you closer to God today and your desire to worship Him. So grateful for those that are singing and the musicians, not just today, but every week, the sound booth, the video guys that do so much to help us in our worship and in our study of God's Word. This week, we are starting off our Revive the Family seminar, our revival, if you will. Joe Hines is with us. Joe is the executive director at the Woodburn Christian Children's Home in Northern Indiana, in the preaching ministry for a number of years, and he's just had a great impact on the Northern Indiana area through the ministry of Woodburn, but also now throughout the Brotherhood as he does these seminars, not only him, but others from the Children's Home. It's a mission that we've supported for a couple of years. It's a vital ministry in that area, but really in changing lives of not just the children, but families also. I want to remind you, if you didn't have a chance to grab your communion emblems, they're available on the tables as you enter the door and the table at the back of the room here. And this morning, before we get underway, I want to invite Katie and Sean Majors to the stage. Sean was baptized this spring here, and Katie and he were married just about a month ago, and really grateful for them. She wants to place her membership with our congregation, along with her husband, of course. And so I'm going to ask everybody to stand together. Ask Katie to affirm, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God? Yes. All right. And let's repeat together, I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Amen. Let's pray. Father, as we begin our time of corporate worship here today, we just are so thankful that Katie and Sean have committed their lives to you, committed their marriage to you, and pray you'll bless them in the years to come. Grateful that they're a part of our church family, and Father, may we support them and guide them in their faith journey, but also, Lord, may they contribute well to the work of this congregation. We thank you for each one that's gathered here today. May you be glorified in name, Father, and in action, and in the heart of every person that's here as we worship you in spirit and truth. It's in Christ's name we pray.
I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, and praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when outnumbered, praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the water my enemy praise, cause I know you're still in control. My praise is a weapon, it's more than a sound. My praise is the shout that brings Jericho down. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. I've got to praise the Lord, oh my soul. And I won't be quiet, my God is alive, so how can I keep it inside? I've got to praise. Cause you're sovereign, praise cause you reign, praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise cause you're sovereign, praise cause you reign, praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. And we've got to praise the Lord, oh my soul. And we've got to praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Worship together, Lord. I just pray that you'll be with Joe today as he speaks and that we'll learn so much from this week. So, Lord, I just pray that you'll be with us as we continue our worship to you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Souls of men. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of your trespasses according to the riches of his grace. 1 Peter 1:18, starting in verse 1:18, it says, "For you are now clothed." Wrong verse. "Knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold, and your futile ways you inherited from your forefathers, but with the precious blood of the Lamb of the Most High." That is why we are here. On the first day of the week, we come to remember exactly what Christ has done for each and every one of us, because our sins are forgiven by his blood. We are unique. We are different. That's okay. That's what this world needs to see each and every day, as long as we live it out. And the good thing is, not only are we forgiven, we are different, unique, clothed with Christ, but God sees us as his children to one day inherit the kingdom of God. So let us remember those things, that because of what Christ did on the cross, we are different, we are holy, and we're covered with his blood. Let us pray. Father God in heaven, Lord, we just thank you for this day. Father, we're so grateful for your willingness, Father, to send your Son to take our stead, to forgive us of all our trespasses. And Father, we just thank you. And Jesus, we can't thank you enough for leaving your home, Father, to take the place of each and every one of us on that cross. Father, we don't deserve your grace and your mercy, but you bestow upon us. Father, you've given us the way of salvation that is simple. Father, if we just follow the simple plan, Father, if we repent, Father, if we're baptized into Christ, that we can have our sins forgiven and your blood covers it all. Father, we just hope that we partake in a worthy manner, that everything that our life represents day in and day out will bring glory and honor unto you. For these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
I began serving at the Woodburn Christian Children's Home in 2016. We didn't understand the call at first, but we knew God was laying it on our hearts to serve here, my wife and I. And then once we got involved, it became pretty clear that we had a responsibility to bring the truth of God's love into the hearts of discouraged children and families. God is truly on the move, certainly through the lives of the children. They come here through all kinds of tragic stories. Nobody comes to the Woodburn Christian Children's Home on a winning streak.
The reason I came here was because I kept getting in trouble and I would lie and steal and stuff like that. So my parents brought me here to get help.
I had problems with respecting my mom, and she kind of had problems with me and what the things I did.
When they come, the children feel like they've been thrown away. And we get to meet them in that spot of desperation. And in that is where God's love is so powerfully shown.
It was hard, because I was scared to, like, I was nervous to meet everybody, and I just didn't know anybody here. So the kids around here, they're nice and stuff. My house parents, they would, like, talk me through stuff if I was, like, getting sad or something, and just being able to be around people and socialize.
I was nervous that I wouldn't be accepted because I've had problems with people making fun of how I looked, so I kind of just told myself, if they don't like me for who I am, then so what, they can suck it up. I prefer it here than going home, because I have a lot of friends here more than I do at home. And at home, I feel like I'm an outsider coming back or just visiting or something. And then here, it's like, this is my family, and it's like I've known everybody for my entire life.
Maybe anytime any one of us sees these children, we always see the contrast of what it was like, what happened, and what it's like now. And certainly in the life of Anthony, that's very obvious. And Carly is one of those young ladies that truly has a story of God's glory.
It's helped my future a lot, I would say, because my future wouldn't have been that bright if I didn't come here. God in my life is, I still believe in him. I still believe that the only reason I'm here is because of him. And the only reason I'm doing better is because of him.
I really thought that he'd just given up and gone. He didn't really care and just said, oh, I made a mistake with her. Might as well just give up, throw her in the trash and be done with her. Well, now I see it differently, that he was always there. He didn't leave me, and he never will. No matter what, you're not a mistake, and you matter.
We do not raise victims, we raise overcomers, to help them see themselves in a different picture of life, where God is central. And so now we raise strong and courageous children who are overcomers in Christ.
I've realized that if I'm honest and I'll behave, my relationship at home will get better, and it has gotten a lot better.
The more I opened up, the more I saw everything, including the world, differently.
We don't have expenses at the Woodburn Christian Children's Home. We have investments in children. We're privately funded through the Christian community. There's ways to participate by coming to our fundraisers. We have a fundraiser in the spring, a golf outing, and we have a fundraiser in the fall, in October, our benefit auction. Over 700 people. Last year, we raised almost $200,000. This is 300 items that we auction off. All these items are donated. It's everything you can imagine. It's a great place to go Christmas shopping. Our kids look forward to it, and so do so many of our partners.
All right. Good morning, and good morning. It's so good to be here. My wife is so grateful that I'm here, because if I'm not here, I'm preaching at her. But don't get me wrong, she does need as many sermons as I do. And so she's grateful when I'm preaching outside the house and not as much inside. I don't know if you two have that experience. But see, I'm so glad to be here today. And Helen has been so gracious in providing a place for me to sleep at. And what a wonderful, beautiful home she has. And you folks are just great to be alongside of. And this video, it really does give me hope for the human race. We don't raise victims at the Woodburn Christian Children's Home. We raise overcomers. And all those folks serving there, whether it's Heather and Jason Stoner or Hal and Carol Rogers, we have the house parents who live there 24/7, all these folks have answered the call to serve in an environment where kids can overcome the mess. And everybody's got something to overcome. Nobody's exempt from it. Everybody has something. Everybody's got a villain, and therefore everybody can feel victimized. These kids certainly have been victimized. But on some level, the gospel helps us overcome that. In all things and in all ways, sometimes quickly, sometimes slowly, we overcome the mess. We're transformed. Kind of like what we talked about in Sunday school today. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed. That's what we see at the Woodburn Christian Children's Home. We tell folks all the time that we're not a facility, we're not an institution, we're not a service provider. We're a Christian home, just like where you live. You're not a facility, you're not a service provider, even though you do provide a service, wiping noses and giving meals and all the other stuff you do, but at the end of the day, a Christian home. These kids come from messy places, but God's got a solution. Even in your own lives, like what was mentioned during the communion meditation, God's got a solution, and it's the Christian home. I believe it all flows out of the Christian home. Your first church, my first church, is at my home address. My second church is the Heartland Church of Christ. Your second church is Millwood Church of Christ. But all ministry flows from our homes outward. And that's a big deal. That was something I had to be retrained in. And it took time, but everything happens from the inside out. And I'm thankful to serve at the Woodburn Christian Children's. Don't tell the board of directors, but they don't have to pay me to do what I do. I just love it. I love messing with the kids. I love seeing that transformation. I don't know, has anybody ever felt like Carly, like a throwaway? You ever feel like you were just a mistake and that God should have just thrown you in the trash? I mean, I could echo those sentiments. And that's how she felt when she showed up. And it was messy. But at the end of the day, even though her behaviors were voicing the mess, our house parents sat there in the trenches with them, just like you do with your kids, sitting in the trenches with them, learning and being able to help them see Christ despite the mess. And that's what we're going to talk about during this message, and then we're going to further unpack it tonight and the next three nights and kind of see how this happens. How do we raise overcomers in the 21st century? And how does that happen in our home as the church is the helper? As Zach and the youth team is the helper. I mean, these folks on stage today, Lance and the team, I almost forgot I was preaching. They give me hope for the human race. Like every single one, this lady that was singing over here, it was just, oh my goodness. Yes, this is what she's bought into. And she voices it in that truth. I'm so grateful to have experienced what you guys experienced this morning. If you get a little weary in the next week, hop on and listen to some more of this music that they sang for you today. It'll boost you back up. So we're going to be in Luke chapter 10 today, and we're going to jump into this idea of home. What happens at home? What is a home? And we're going to it's an interesting little passage we're going to step into, because we're going to kind of come alongside Jesus when he goes into a home. And we're going to see what they experienced while Jesus was in the middle of their home. And I believe this is a privileged responsibility, parents, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, even this home here at the Millwood Church of Christ. You're all surrogate parenting each other and each other's children in the name of Christ. Everybody is included in these messages. Everybody has an influence over a child, whether the child is 8 years old or 38 years old. parenting adult children is just as important as parenting an 8-year-old. And so we're going to get into this idea of God's plan for the home and for the family. And we have it kind of summarized at the children's home up on the screen here. We believe that God has created the family to be His chosen medium for the transmission of godly lifestyle and value. My predecessor, Lee Bracey, was serving at the children's home for 34 years. He coined this phrase. He's a dear mentor of mine. And I was just with him on Monday last week. But family is God's chosen medium for the transmission of godly lifestyle and value. So that means the Millwood Church of Christ is your helper. But it is our responsibility, your responsibility in your home to create that environment where godly lifestyle and values is transmitted. That's a big deal. That's a huge responsibility. I mean, my wife and I, we get it. We're no different than anybody else. It's our responsibility too. And for me, I got a built-in forgetter. My wife always tells me this. And so for me, I actually took some of our grandkids, their handprints, and I put it in my Bible. And Mark, I chose the Gospel of Mark. I figured it was easy for them to get their brains wrapped around. Now, they're all 5 years old and younger. But every time I open up my Bible, I'm reminded that I'm a Christian grandfather and I'm a Christian father. Anybody can buy in matchbox cars and ice cream cones, but I have the privilege and responsibility as a Christian grandfather and father to teach Christ in everything we do. And we're going to unpack that again tonight, the rest of the nights, and everywhere we go, even if we're putting on Christian music in the background. It's our privileged responsibility to be that platform where Christ is taught, because if we don't teach it at home, those 120 hours they're awake, who's going to teach them? And that's what we're going to kind of get into. And it's an interesting way of looking at this passage in Luke chapter 10, because it gives us this idea of okay, Jesus in the home. What does this look like? And it's actually going to pick up in verse 38. And I'm just going to read the passage, and then we'll kind of jump into it and talk our way through it in different places. But Luke 10, verses 38 through 42, an interesting little passage. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." And then the Lord answers, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken from her." So this is a scenario where Jesus stops at the home of Martha with his disciples. And we get to learn a lot about when Jesus comes into her home. Now, before we really kind of dig into the text, we have to set it in context. And I mentioned it during Sunday school. At the Woodburn Christian Children's Home, we teach the kids biblical doctrine. But just as importantly, we teach them how to read the Bible, how to extract biblical doctrine themselves. And in this particular phrase, starting this passage, as Jesus and his disciples were on their way, that phrase is supposed to cause us to pause. And I mentioned in Sunday school that I'm from the East Coast, and when I see a speed bump, I speed up. Don't tell me what to do. But this is like a speed bump passage, right? As Jesus and his disciples are on their way, we're supposed to ask ourselves, where are they on their way to? It's very important to set it in context. Where are they on their way to? They stop at the home of Martha. Is this just some random stop? Of all the things that could have been included in the Bible, this 4 verses, they stop in the home of Martha. Why was it included? Well, that's what we want to discover today. And to answer your question, why and where are they going, we have to go back to Luke chapter 9, verse 51. I don't know if anybody here read Luke 1 through 9 this morning. Okay, so we should really set it in context. Luke 9:51 answers the where and the why. It's this beautiful passage. Luke 9:51 says, "As a time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem." Jesus was in the northern part of the kingdom, and as the scripture suggests, as the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, he resolutely set out for Jerusalem. Now, he had been to Jerusalem before, right? But he had not been to the cross before. This movement from the northern part of the kingdom to Jerusalem was a movement in his fulfillment of the mission. The crucifixion was not plan B. It was always plan A. It's a prophetic fulfillment of the Old Testament. And when the time had reached the fullness of time, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. Nothing was going to stand in his way as he marched to the cross. What we celebrated during communion, he marched to the cross. And so people would say, and I agree with them, everything from Luke 9, 51, all the way to Luke 19 can be considered the travelogue of Jesus from the northern part of the kingdom to the cross. So it's one of those ideas that if you had a very clear amount of time left, what would you do and what would you say? So a lot could have been recorded on this travelogue. I mean, it's a 4 or 5 day walk from the north to the south. And Martha's home was only maybe a half a day's walk to Jerusalem. So he's close. So on the way to the cross, Jesus stops at her home, I think, for us. So we get to learn what can happen when Christ is in the middle of your home. I think it's very appropriate to what we're talking about this week. So let's get into this. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted. Isn't that interesting? People ask me, what is home? All the studies we've done over the years, the different degrees that we have represented at the Woodburn Christian Children's Home, we always go back to that question, what is home? Well, this passage is pretty clear. Home is a place where we're easily distracted. I mean, I think everybody can say an amen to that. Home is a place where we're easily distracted. It's real easy for me as a Christian father and grandfather to lose sight of the main thing. I get all caught up in chores and this and that and all. It's at the Woodburn Christian Children's Home. At any given time, we got 20 kids, all with unique physical, educational, emotional, and spiritual needs. And it's real easy for us, if we're not careful, to lose sight of the main thing. Chores. At the children's home, all the kids do chores. Where I live and with my wife and I, our adult kids, they even do chores when they come home. They know they're chopping wood or they're cleaning up after Sunday dinner. They're participating in life somehow. I'm not doing it all. And chores are important, but they're not the main thing. When our kids were younger, we used to have them take the right amount of food for their plate so that they finished it all. Don't throw away God's blessings. At the children's home, we teach the kids all of our food is donated to us. We feed 30 to 35 people on $200 or $300 a month. Everything else comes in through donations. So we teach the kids, right, that when they take their food, you finish everything on your plate. Don't throw away God's blessings. But again, that's not the main thing. We teach the kids to do their homework and to turn it in, which I didn't realize this is a two-step process. Do your homework and physically take it to school and turn it in. We have these kids who are like, oh, yeah, I didn't feel like turning it in. What? You took 35 minutes to do your homework. You didn't turn it in? No, I didn't feel like it. It's like, okay, well, there's gravel to pick out of the grass. So, I mean, we always give them chores to do to make up for their dumbness. But homework, as important as it is not the main thing. And, of course, we teach the kids, for the love of God, to get along. They're like top spinning on a table. They get close to each other. They don't like to share the air with each other. I don't know if you've got any teenagers like that or middle schoolers. They don't like to share the air. And so we teach the kids to get along. But again, that's not the main thing. One of our house dads, years ago, he remembers a time where one of the boys was way behind on school. Just 20 assignments behind. And so he was going to work with him to get him caught up. Because again, what we do reflects how we feel and think. And they wanted to work with us. So they stay up till midnight doing that. And it was frustrating for the child. It was frustrating for the house dad. Afterward, a couple days later, he came and he said, you know what? I think I missed a mark on that. I think I emphasized homework too much and I lost sight of the main thing. We keep each other accountable. Martha, we know, She was distracted, rightfully so. Jesus and his disciples came to her house. Now, we don't know how many disciples, maybe to 12. Maybe she was hosting 13 people. I mean, that's a lot. It is a lot of preparations to be made. At least sweep the dirt under the carpet and take the goats out. I mean, there's a lot of preparations. Martha was right in being distracted by all the preparations. And of course, at this point in time, many believe she knew the identity of Jesus. It wasn't just some random teacher coming to her house. She believed that he was the long-awaited Messiah. And of course, with the long-awaited Messiah is coming to your house, there are some preparations that had to be made. But Jesus and his beautiful wisdom just simply brought her back onto the main thing. He didn't scold her. All he said to her was, "Martha, Martha, you are distracted by many things and upset by many things, but there is only one thing that is needed." He brought her back to the main thing. Home is a place where we're easily distracted, and sometimes we just seem to have the reset button. Even at the church home, sometimes we get caught up in all kinds of things and we miss the main thing. There was a movement about 20 years ago called Simple Church. It was this movement to bring the church back to the main thing. All this different programming and all these things they could be involved in. Are we keeping Christ the main thing? Because after all, home is God's place for the transmission of godly lifestyle and value. So we got to be careful with the distractions. That's just the first thing we learn. We also learn, interestingly enough, from this passage, from the question mark. I don't know if you've ever recognized the fact that the question marks that we have in our English rendering, these question marks are not in the original languages of Hebrew, Greek, and Aramaic. They don't have question marks in that language. We render that language into English using question marks, exclamation points, and commas, and different things just to help us get the passage. But this question mark in here is a very unique one. I don't know if you've ever studied the question marks in the Bible. Does anybody remember who asked the first question recorded in the Bible? The very beginning of the Bible, who asked the first question? It starts with an S and ends with serpent. I mean, the serpent. The serpent asked the first. What did the serpent say to Eve? Did God really say? I was just talking about this with Justin in between. Did God really say? That was the first question recorded in the Bible. Now, what's the second question? God asked him, what did you do? And there's been a lot of questions ever since. Hopping from question mark in the Bible is a powerful study. Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? There are so many question marks in the Bible that voice a person's heart and voice a person's condition. We talked about in Sunday school how behaviors and language voice what a person's thinking. It's like a children's book. One side of the book is a sentence that says, a duck is alone. The corresponding page is a picture of a duck by itself. The picture illustrates the narrative. A child's behavior, even if that child's 38 years old, a child's behavior and their language illustrates the narrative. They're gateways into a person's heart. And so Martha asked Jesus a question. And it's an interesting question, keeping in mind that many believe that she knew the identity of Jesus. She knew the identity of Jesus. Let's just assume that. And so if Jesus is in your living room, of all the questions you could ask him, would you ask him the question Martha did? Martha went to Jesus and said, "Lord, don't you care?" He's a half a mile, maybe a mile from the cross. He's about to put on this. He's the fulfillment of the suffering servant in Isaiah 53. And she goes to him and says, "Lord, don't you care?" Isn't that interesting? I don't know if you could echo that question. I could echo that question. "Lord, don't you care what's happening to these children? Lord, don't you care that that person said, Lord, don't you care that I feel like this?" I had a head cold earlier this week. I was whining. My wife wasn't giving me any sympathy. I'm like, "I got to go to Millwood in a couple days. I feel so hard." But she's like, "Uh." And so she didn't care. No matter how much I whined about it, I was like, woman. And so but it was just our fun. It's our little banter that we do because there's no kids to mess with anymore. So we're empty nesters. So she asked Jesus, Lord, don't you care? And I think that's a silly question. I don't want to say it's a stupid question, but I think it's a silly question. It's a silly question. But it's her home. And I think home should be a safe place to ask a silly question. Do you think home should be a safe place to ask a silly question? If your home is not a safe place to ask a silly question or a stupid question, who are they going to ask? Well, it doesn't take a rocket scientist. They're going to pull their phone out and ask the people on their phone. Those little mystic people on their phone, these truth tellers from their phone, these internet dwellers on their phone. The truth is on the phone. If we don't create a safe environment for people to ask silly questions, who are they going to ask? Home needs to be protected from ridicule. There's a living room for living, a kitchen for cooking, a dining room for dining. There's no room designated to make someone feel dumb. And of course, when kids are young, they ask all kinds of questions. They're trying to feel out their world through question. As they get older, they ask questions. And sometimes the questions are surprising. I'll never forget it. My son, Joey, when he was like a middle schooler, and of course, you know middle schoolers, I love them, but they can't get away with anything. You smell where they've been and you smell where they're going. I mean, he was a middle schooler, and Joey, we're driving to Good Friday service. I'm a preacher, right? He's been raised in a biblical worldview. He should have some thoughts about this. We're driving to Good Friday service. I think he had an attitude to begin with to go, but nonetheless, we're driving to Good Friday service, and he barks up from the back seat. Why do they call Good Friday good? That's when he was murdered. I think this is dumb. I mean, I almost pulled the car over. I mean, he would have been used to it, but I almost pulled the car over because he wanted to know why they call Good Friday good. I thought, thankfully, I kept my mouth shut. My wife helped with that, but that's a good question. That led to a tremendous conversation because he had been to hundreds of hours of Sunday school and camp and youth. The kids went to all that stuff because it gave us a break from them, and they went to everything. The youth group should be packed here, and so Joey was taught all of that, but in our home, he needed to flesh that out. Why do they call Good Friday good? I think home should be a safe place to ask a dumb question. We should protect the sanctity. I think the Sunday school classes here, there should be zero ridicule for the dumb questions. When I came to Christ on February 3rd, 2002, I didn't know hardly anything besides the fact that my life was in full-blown train wreck mode. And I wasn't getting run over by the engine at that point. The caboose was on top of me. I mean, it had been going on for a while. I was 34 years old. And I came to Christ on February 3rd, 2002. I got right into Sunday school, and I had no clue. Easter was coming. So I had to raise my hand. What are we celebrating Easter for again? And I'm so grateful. I can get choked up about it. I'm so grateful. Rick, the preacher at the Parkway Church of Christ, didn't look at me like I had three heads. I mean, he did other times, but that particular time he didn't. And he just explained to me what we're celebrating on Easter. Sunday school should be a safe place to ask a silly youth group around the campfire. Jesus, she asked Jesus, Lord, don't you care? And Jesus responded, Martha, Martha. He didn't say, you're dumb, I can't believe you asked that question. He said, Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. He just brought it to the main thing. Now, at the Woodburn Christian Children's Home, we get a lot of big questions. Now, we get the younger kids, because we go down to 6 years old. We're the only one licensed down to 6 years old over in really all the tri-state area. And these little eight-year-olds, when they start getting into the Word, they're like the one boy. He's like, "Where are the dinosaurs in the Bible?" He couldn't find the dinosaurs in it. He was looking for the D word. Where's the D word? And that was a big deal to him. It wasn't a big deal to me, but it was a big deal to him. He wanted to know where the dinosaurs. I'm so grateful he asked his house parents and us where the dinosaurs are. We have other big questions, certainly, that come into it, and some of them are big questions. Big questions like the existence of evil in a world created by a good God. That's a worldview question. These kids are wrestling with it as fourth and fifth graders. That horrible shooting that happened down in Georgia. Do you think the kids were thinking about that the next day? Do you think they're thinking about that the next day? Yes, they are. They want to know if God's all-powerful in all places at all times, where was he when that boy left his algebra class to go get his weapon? And he was coming back into class, but they wouldn't let him in, so he shot four people right outside the door. Where is God in that mess? These kids have these questions. And if we don't create a safe environment for them to wrestle with theodicy, which is a technical term for the existence of evil in the world created, if we don't give them the environment to test those waters, who in the world are they going to ask? Well, we know who they're going to ask. The kids in our care. Why? Where was God when my mom OD'd? Where was God when I was being abused? Where was God when we were living in the car? All of these things are happening for the kids that come into our care. They want to know, where is God in the middle of the mess? The answer is in the book. And home is where we teach it. So that's a really interesting thing that pops out of this passage. Certainly the distractions, the question mark. And one more thing I want to pull out of this is the obvious, which is the conflict. Conflict. I believe if you're in a relationship for more than 48 seconds, you're going to have conflict. Conflict is something you cannot avoid. We learn how to manage it. On Monday night, we're doing a deep dive into how to manage conflict with families. How do you deal with the temper tantrums? How do you de-escalate an escalated kid? Well, one, just for a sneak peek, you don't raise up to where an escalated parent cannot de-escalate an escalated child. I mean, that's like the thesis of it. But how do you manage conflict in the middle of the mess? Martha was mad. I mean, she was upset. She comes to Jesus. Don't you care that my sister's left me to do all the work? Tell her to help me. I mean, she's in the kitchen, so to speak, doing the deal, and her sister's sitting at Jesus' feet. It's a powerful image, but it's irritating from Martha's point of view. She was angry. My wife and I, it's been a fun journey of 30 years learning how to manage conflict. It takes time. It takes time. And where we live, little tiny town, Auburn, Indiana, there's two ways to go to Walmart. There's my way, and there's the wrong way. And she always takes the wrong way. It's irritating. Why are you going that way? This is the better. She gives me the hint. All right. We're back to managing conflict, aren't we? I mean, it's all the little things. This is a little thing. Now, keep in mind, she was prepping for a lot of people, like I said. It wasn't just a few people. There could have been 30 people. We don't know. It doesn't tell us. All we know is she was angry. And there's a very intentional way to manage conflict. And I believe it's something we have to teach our kids. I don't know if it's inborn, necessarily. I don't know if it's inborn. We're going to talk about that image in Genesis 4 where sin was crouching at the door of the heart right after the fall. But I really believe we have to teach the kids this. I see this. All of this is illustrated through my crazy family. I mean, just my kids are like me. They do all dumb stuff. But my younger son, he's 25 now. When he was 4.5 years old, I'm sitting Saturday morning, 10 a.m. I'm drinking coffee, looking out the big bay window of our backyard. It was a cul-de-sac house. I was an engineer. We had a ton of money. And I'm looking out the back window, and our middle school girl comes racing through the view of the window, this terrified look on her face, but she was smiling. And I'm drinking my coffee, and I'm thinking, at this point in my parenting career, if I'm not invited, I'm not joining. So I'm just, they'll figure it out. And so I didn't go outside. And then, just a second later, her younger sister, woof, view of the window, smile, terror. I was like, huh, that's interesting. And I poured a little more coffee. And then, just a second later, our younger son comes running through the view of the window carrying a plastic baseball bat. He was chasing them down. And I don't know what they did, although I kind of have an idea. He'd show up at the door once in a while wearing Barbie slippers. I'm not sure what happened, but he was angry, and he was going to manage conflict his way. Now, I never taught him to chase his sisters with a plastic baseball bat. I don't think he got it from SpongeBob SquarePants. I'm not sure where he picked it up from, but that was his management methodologies at the time. If we don't teach our kids how to manage conflict, who will? And we know the answer to that. It's horrendous. We have the privileged responsibility, and I believe it's a responsibility to teach our kids how to manage conflict. Martha, she teaches us the first step in managing conflict. Interestingly enough, in that little tiny passage, Remember, there was people in her house. Was Peter there? Most likely. Was Andrew? I don't know. Were the sons of thunder there? Possibly. John? And I don't know who was. Jesus and his disciples were on their way. So there may have been a lot of people in that house. So Martha, she could have gone to one of the sons of thunder, possibly. That might have worked. She could have gone to Peter and said, you see what this loser's doing? I'm out here doing it. She's sitting there lounging at the feet of Jesus. She could have gone to a lot of people with her slander and with her gossip. But she chose to go to Jesus. That's always the first step in conflict management. There's a passage I was talking about in Sunday school where King David wrote in the Psalms, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. That's such beautiful imagery. That rock provides a new perspective of the conflict. When someone catches me off guard, right away, lead me to the rock that's higher than I. Really, because I just want to see it from God's point of view. I was serving at the Auburn Church of Christ a couple years into it. I'm walking across the gym on the way to services. It was like 10:25, service starts at 10:30. And this lady, one of the senior saints in the church, just captures me right in the middle of the gym. She was really upset. And I wasn't smart enough to look at her body language on the way in. She was really upset. And she confronts me really close to my face and says, who changed the juice? And I was like, what are we talking about here, lady? I mean, is it orange juice? I mean, I wasn't sure. What's going on? She was so upset. And she said, who changed the communion juice? And at that split second, I didn't know what to say. All what came out of my mouth was not me. It was God kind of puppeteering me. What came out of my mouth was, I am so grateful that you're passionate for communion. I wish everybody had that passion for communion. That's what came out of my mouth. In the background, I'm thinking, leave me to rock this higher than I. Leave me to rock this. What is this lady upset about? And she was, communion is so special to her. She was familiar with the taste of the juice. And when they changed the manufacturer of the juice, it tasted different. And it messed up her worship experience. There's a lot to be said about predictability in worship. But the point was, conflict comes out of the blue. We can't see it coming, and it's really important for us to teach our kids how to manage conflict. I mean, Dave, it's really important because, after all, they have access to your toothbrush when you're not home. Think about that for a second. You better learn to manage conflict with the folks you're living with because they have access to your toothbrush when you're not home. They could use this to clean the toilet and do all kinds of stuff just to draw out the image. I want you to understand. So, yeah, he's looking at his wife. So it's important for us. It's essential for us to teach conflict management tools. Now, Monday, we're going to dive deep into that. But the first one here, it's the relational triangle. Martha's on one point of the triangle. Mary's on the other point of the triangle. Martha's upset with Mary. She appeals to a higher person, God. It's the classic relational triangle. You're in them all the time. I was in them all the time. That same Joey used to go to his mom before dinner and say, I want some ice cream. 6, 8 years old middle schooler, she'd say, you're not getting ice cream before dinner. You know what he did? He came to me. He said, Dad, I want ice cream. And I was like, well, as long as you bring me some. I mean, he was managing the relational triangle. So it happens all the time. Relational triangles are the building block of all families. We're going to get into that tonight. It's really important to understand what we're participating in. And so Martha goes to Jesus, and he helps her manage the conflict by bringing her back to the main thing. Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing matters. So often conflict is rooted in majoring and minors. So often conflict is rooted in losing sight of the eternal significance. Most of the stuff I get upset about has no eternal significance. This is a reset button for families. It's a reset button for me. When I was studying this, I was like, okay, God, so you meant this for me at first. So I get to give you the overflow, but it's really important to us to understand what happens at home. Home is a place where we're easily distracted. Home was a place to ask silly questions, and home was a place to teach how to manage conflict. And just as a conclusion, home is also a retreat. You know those girls that Saturday morning when their brother was chasing them down with a bat? I know that sounds bad from a distance, but he would never have caught them, which is why they get involved. But you know where those girls ran to that morning? They didn't run to the 7-Eleven. We lived they didn't run to the neighbor's house. They ran into our home. Why? Because our home is and continues to be a retreat. Is your home a safe place to retreat to? It's really, really important. This diagram we have up on the board describes a home, that platform of permanency, where the adults are characterized by availability, predictability, and accountability. We create this platform of permanency, then the kids will naturally, regardless of their age, will naturally develop physically, educationally, emotionally, spiritually, in a Christ-centered way. Home, this home church must be a safe place to retreat to. Interestingly enough, not to take away from the divinity of Jesus, but you have to ask ourselves, why did Jesus stop at Martha's home? He was, the cross is coming. There was a plan in place. So I asked myself when I was prepping for this, why did Jesus stop at Martha's home? I don't know. Maybe she makes good egg rolls. I don't know why was it for the food? Well, yeah, possibly. Drake, I mean, it's a central ridge. Jerusalem was up on a ridge. Everybody walked up to Jerusalem, even if they were going south. They walked up to, it's really steep, dried up riverbeds. I mean, it's a hard walk. Maybe he went there because he needed some physical strength, some water. But I also think he went there because he wanted to be with the people whom he knew loved him. Home is characterized by that love. Jesus, I think, in my personal opinion, went to Martha's home because he wanted to be someplace where he knew he fit right before he was about to be abandoned and fled by his disciples and crucified. Home must be a retreat. It's like Isaiah. God spoke through Isaiah in chapter 32. God said to Isaiah, to the people through Isaiah, and interestingly enough, this passage is addressed to the women of Jerusalem. God said, my people will live in peaceful dwelling places. It's describing after the exile. My people will live in secure homes. My people will live in undisturbed places of rest. Does that describe your home? It does for me at times. At times it doesn't. It's a reset. I wasn't raised in a home like this. I was raised in a very toxic home. But my home is this is our goal, Isaiah 32. Because after all, home at the end of the day is ultimately not about a place to live, but about the people with whom you are most fully alive. Isn't that a cool way to look at home? It's a place where you're with people with whom you are most fully alive. That's the privilege we have for each other, for our children, for our neighbors, cousins, just everybody. So I pray that this message, as simple as it is in its scriptural presentation, will feed your soul and reset the truth in your heart. Let's keep the main thing the main thing. Please join me in prayer. Gracious Father, Lord, as we gather this morning and we're realizing the truth ever so more in our gathering, we praise you, Lord, for the opportunity to be together. Strengthen the families, Father. Help us to be truth to those that we know. And help us to know that you love us. We pray this in Christ. Amen. So just real quick, raise your hand. Everybody raise your hand. Just play this game. Just please do it. I will make you do push-ups. So raise your hand. Okay. And so put your hands down if you don't know any kids. Okay, cool. So we'll have a house full tonight. If you know a kid, you should probably come tonight. We're gonna discover some really great stuff together. Thanks.
Thank you. We want to thank you so much for joining us this morning. Thank you, Joe, for being here for today and then the rest of the week. There's more information about the Woodburn Christian Children's Home just outside here if you're interested in that. It's also back there on the missions. It is a mission that we support quarterly. And so we're hoping that you invest in this time and give Joe the audience that he has studied so well to be able to deserve. And we're just so interconnected, and I'm just so thankful for you and the mission that you're doing. We've had over 15 kids go out there for mission trips. Dylan just reached out to me last month saying, hey, we need some more help. So next year it looks like we might be doing some more work with them. And I'm a little nervous. So Anthony, one of the boys that you mentioned, every time he sees me, I don't know why, because I'm not the basketball type. I quit playing basketball in fourth grade because I quit growing in the fourth grade. And every time Anthony sees me, he always wants to play. And I'm proud to say I'm 2-0, okay? I'm proud to say that. The problem is, with the passing of time, he is getting better, and I'm not, okay? So next year might be his year. But thank you so much for being here. I want to invite you tonight, 5 p.m., we're going to have a dinner out back, and then at 7, we're going to begin continue with the seminar. And then that's going to go on 7 o'clock clear through Wednesday, so a lot of good stuff there. Also want to direct your attention to that back bulletin board. There's several sign-ups back there. There's the golf outing coming up. There's also Linda's ladies outing, the wiener roast and hayride at the Bullock Farm. So if you can go back there and sign up for that and what you'd be bringing. And then the next thing regarding families, out on the welcome desk, there are fall festival invites. So that's one of our largest community outreaches that we do here. It's going to be October 5th. If you have kids, you know kids, you're neighbors with kids, you have grandkids, whatever it might be, grab one of those invites. Maybe you have a business and you want to set them out there. Help us promote that so we can have as many people rub shoulders with Jesus as possible come October 5th. So with that being said, just thank you so much for being here, and thank you so much, Joe. If you would, please join us in prayer.
God, we just want to thank you so much for this time that we've had to come together to worship and praise you. Lord, thank you so much for Joe and just the message that he shared, and I pray that we'll be able to learn so many things from him over the week. And just, I just pray that you'll be with us as we go about our day. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
What's your impossible? I need a miracle. What's got you barely hanging?